Welcome, my friends, to Art House Radio. I am Troy. Thank you for joining me. It's nice to be with you. On this episode, I'm reading a couple of letters, a poem, and then playing a clip of David Sedaris on The Late Show, reading a passage from his work, Stadium Pal. So the first two letters are from Siegfried Sassoon, who was in the British Army, and he was writing angrily to his superiors, whom he felt were prolonging the war unnecessarily, quite understandably upset. The second letter is from Abraham Lincoln to a woman, a girl named Fanny, who lost her father. The third reading is a poem by the aforementioned Siegfried Sassoon called Everybody Sang. And finally, we'll hear a clip of David Sedaris on The Late Show with David Letterman many years ago. I hope you enjoy it. Remember to follow everywhere at arthouse.radio, and I'm at Spaces with Light. And if you are in a position where you can support the show and make a contribution, I encourage you to visit patreon.com/arthouseradio. All right, I hope you enjoy it, and I'll see you soon. Lieutenant Siegfried Sassoon, 3rd Battalion, Royal Welsh Fusiliers, July 1917. I am making this statement as an act of willful defiance of military authority, because I believe that the war is being deliberately prolonged by those who have the power to end it. I am a soldier, convinced that I am acting on behalf of soldiers. I believe that the war upon which I entered as a war of defense and liberation has now become a war of aggression and conquest. I believe that the purposes for which I and my fellow soldiers entered upon this war should have been so clearly stated as to have made it impossible to change them, and that had this been done, the objects which actuated us would now be attainable by negotiation. I have seen and endured the sufferings of the troops, and I can no longer be a party to prolong these sufferings for ends which I believe to be evil and unjust. I am not pressing against the conduct of the war, but against the political errors and insincerities for which the fighting men are being sacrificed. On behalf of those who are suffering now, I make this protest against the deception which is being practiced upon them. Also, I believe it may help to destroy the callous complacency with which the majority of those at home regard the continuance of agonies which they do not share and which they have not enough imagination to realize. This is a letter from Abraham Lincoln to Fanny. Dear Fanny, it is with deep grief that I learn of the death of your kind and brave father, and especially that it is affecting your young heart beyond what is common in such cases. In this sad world of ours, sorrow comes to all, and to the young it comes with bittersweet agony because it takes them unawares. The older have learned to ever expect it. I am anxious to afford some alleviation of your present distress. Perfect relief is not possible, except with time. You cannot now realize that you will ever feel better. Is not this so? And yet it is a mistake. You are sure to be happy again. To know this, which is certainly true, will make you some less miserable now. I have had the experience enough to know what I say, and you need only to believe it to feel better at once. The memory of your dear father, instead of an agony, will yet be a sad, sweet feeling in your heart of a purer and holier sort than you have ever known before. Please present my kind regards to your afflicted mother. Your sincere friend, Abraham Lincoln. Everyone Sang by Siegfried Sassoon. Everyone suddenly burst out singing, and I was filled with such delight as prisoned birds must find in freedom, winging wildly across the white orchards and dark green fields, on, and out of sight. Everyone's voice was suddenly lifted, and beauty came like the setting sun. My heart was shaken with tears, and horror drifted away. Oh, but everyone was a bird, and the song was wordless. The singing will never be done.
Mr. Sedaris is kind enough to read for us tonight one of his essays. David?
A while back, Esquire asked me to contribute to their style issue, and I don't really have any. And so I wrote a series of essays devoted to some of my more depressing mistakes, and this is one of them. I've always liked the idea of accessories, those little pick-me-ups designed to invigorate what has come to feel drab and predictable. A woman might rejuvenate her outfit with a vintage Hermes scarf or jaunty rope belt, but the options for men aren't nearly as interesting. I'm not the type for cufflinks or suspenders, and while I'll occasionally pick up a new tie, it hardly leaves me feeling kicky. Hidden accessories can do the trick, but again, they're mainly the providence of women. Garter belt and lingerie, yes. Sock garter and micro brief, no. It was my search for something discreet, masculine, and practical that led me to the Stadium Pal, an external catheter currently being marketed to sports fans, truck drivers, and anyone else who's tired of searching for a bathroom. At first inspection, the device met all my criteria. Was it masculine? Yes, and proudly so. Knowing that no sensible female would ever voluntarily choose to pee in her pants, the manufacturers went ahead and designed a product exclusively for men. Unlike a regular catheter, which is inserted directly into the penis, the Stadium Pal connects by way of a self-adhesive condom, which is then attached to a flexible rubber tube. Urine flows through the tube and collects in the Freedom leg bag, conveniently attached to the user's calf. The bag can be emptied and reused up to 12 times, making it both disgusting and cost-effective. And what could be manlier? Was it discreet? According to the brochure, unless you wore it with shorts, no one needed to know a thing about it. Was it practical? At the time, yes. I don't drive or attend football games, but I did have a book tour coming up, and the possibilities were endless. 5 glasses of iced tea followed by a long public reading. Thanks, Stadium Pal. The window seat on an overbooked cross-country flight? Don't mind if I do. I ordered myself a Stadium Pal and realized that while it might make sense in a hospital, it really wasn't very practical for day-to-day use. In an open-air sporting arena, a piping hot 32-ounce bag of urine might go unnoticed. But not so in a stuffy airplane or a small crowded bookstore. An hour after christening it, I smelled like a nursing home. On top of that, I found that it was hard to pee and do other things at the same time. Reading out loud, discussing my dinner options with a flight attendant, checking into a fine hotel. Each activity required its own separate form of concentration. And while no one knew exactly what I was up to, it was pretty clear that something was going on. I think it was my face that gave me away. That and my oddly swollen calf. What ultimately did me in was a self-adhesive condom. Putting it on was no problem, but its removal qualified as what, in certain cultures, is known as a bris. Wear it once and you'll need a solid month in order to fully recover. It would likely be a month in which you'll weigh the relative freedom of peeing in your pants against the unsightly discomfort of, well, scabs. Ultimately realizing that in terms of acute accessory, you're better off with the new watch band.
Very funny, David. David Sedaris, everyone. We'll be right back.